Phenomenal. Hey, I just want to encourage you to get involved somewhere. You know, sometimes I think we got the same people doing the same amount of work, and while the rest of us maybe don't do the work. And so I would encourage you to maybe help out. So if everybody just does their part, what happens is it makes the work really light for everybody. And so I know that that's not just a plug for the church. That's a really, it benefits you when you help. It benefits you when you get involved. And you're like, well, how? It does. Just trust the Lord that as you give your time, God blesses you. And I'm telling you, you can't give out give God. You can't get too involved in church. It'll benefit you, I promise. So do so. Firework tent and all that. And young people, we got our summer camp coming up. And this year, we've kind of gone back to the beach from where it used to be. And listen, summer camp, I'm just going to say this. Sometimes, because we used to go to that big camp, and it was really awesome. It was last year. So sometimes, if you're not careful, you'd be like, oh, we're going back to the beach. I don't know if I... Listen, camp's about getting young people connected with Jesus. It's not about the water slides and all that. That stuff's cool and it's fun and it kind of sometimes draws young people in, but the presence of God is the exact same. And so we've had many lives changed. Autumn Miller, it was one of those that her life was changed in a stinky little room at Twin Rocks Friends Camp. So we need to remember that God moves in kind of anything. And so that's what we're after. That's the point of encounter. That's why we do encounter and everything else that we do. And plus the beach is gorgeous. People go all around the world just to see the beach. So we are excited about camp. So make sure your kids are registered for that. And that is my shameless plug for summer. Welcome. My name is Nate. I am one of the pastors here. I get to hang out with young people most of the time. Every once in a while, I get to hang out with you. And so I'm here today talking to you, and we're continuing our series on the Holy Spirit. I love the Holy Spirit. I'm grateful for the Holy Spirit. I could not preach if it wasn't for the help of the Holy Spirit. I am not confused by that. I know that sometimes preachers say that, and they're really thinking that they can. I can't. I know it. I used to, at 14, I used to run off the stage crying because I was embarrassed to talk in front of people. I still cry up on stage every once in a while, but I won't today, I don't think. So God's good and faithful. Man, I love the Holy Spirit. We should be involved in the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit should be involved in your life. You know what's funny? Is it even just made the news the other day that some lady was making, I won't even say her name, she was making fun of our vice president because he said God talks to him. And I know I'm not trying to get political, but sometimes if you say God talks to you to some of your coworkers, they don't understand. They're like, what? God talks to you? What are you, a psycho? Are you a... is something wrong with you mentally? No, God talks to us, and God should talk to us, and God should be involved with our lives. And if God's not talking to you, it's most of the time because we're probably not tuned into that radio channel, if you may. We're probably allowing other voices in our life to carry more weight than the Word of God and the voice of God and the leading of God. And so God, we very much believe in leading us. The Bible says, well, we'll get into it. Let's first we're going to read Romans, and then we're going to pray, and then we're going to get on the message. It's going to be amazing. You're going to leave here charged, empowered, encouraged, and you're going to go eat some lunch, hopefully a good place, and we'll just have a good Sunday. You ready? Romans chapter 8. I read all of it because I feel like somebody needs it today, but Romans 8 verse 1, we're going to read all the way through 14, so it's a lot of Bible, but you'll be all right. So it says, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who belong to Christ Jesus. We could like take that and go home. You know what I mean? We'd be like, I'm good. Drop the mic. Go home. There's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. It is not your merit. It is not your prayer life. It is not your church attendance. It is nothing that you can do that qualifies you for heaven. It's Jesus. I don't care how smart you are, how good you are, how pure you are, how amazing you are, and some of you are really amazing, but all of you are amazing. Okay, I felt some of you like, what do you mean, is that me? I don't know, some of you. Just leave that open. But it's Jesus that really makes us great. Like, that's the truth. And so, anyways, in verse 2, it says, and because you belong to him, the power of the life-giving Spirit has freed me from the power of sin and death. The law of Moses was unable to save us. Now, remember the law? We had to keep a bunch of rules. I would have been dead like the first week. You know what I mean? I would have, like, I didn't make it past the first. And my wife probably would have gladly stoned me. She's like, she's one of those, like, she keeps the law really well. Okay. She's so good. She's a better Christian than I am. Okay. You think I'm joking. The law of Moses was unable to save us because of the weakness of our sinful nature. So God did what the law could not do, and he sent his only son in a body like the bodies we sinners have. And in that body, God declared an end to sin's control over us by giving his son as a sacrifice for our sins. Let's not just read over this like, oh yeah, yeah, Jesus died for my sins. No, Jesus paid a price we could not pay. Fixed it up for us. Jump down to verse 5. It says, those who are dominated by the sinful nature think about sinful things. Sometimes we get a chance to talk to young people, and all they feed on is YouTube and junk and bad movies, and we're trying to get them to think right and think God thoughts, and then they say, like, oh, man, I'm having really struggles with different temptations, and I'm having, we're like, well, what are you meditating? What are you feeding on? What are you continually putting in your heart? Sometimes people watch like scary movies and they're like, ah, what's the big deal? It doesn't freak me out. But then they're having problems sleeping and they're scared at night. It's like, well, maybe you could put the two together. Like, what do you think? Like, I mean, there's certain things that I just don't watch because I don't want to put that in my spirit. It's not that I'm afraid. It's not that I'm like, I'm stronger than that. I don't want to engage that in my spirit. I keep a tight watch over what I watch. And I know that might not be everybody's conviction, but maybe you can consider it. Keep going. Verse 6. So letting your sinful nature control your mind, it leads to death. But letting the Spirit control your mind leads to life and peace. If you're confused about that, we can talk about that later. Verse 7, for the sinful nature is always hostile towards God. There's a flesh in us that's always hostile towards God. I was driving here the other day, and we were going to pray with the interns. And in the anticipation of prayer, the flesh in me was like, I don't really want to pray right now. I like noticed it in myself. And I know some of you guys are like, this guy's preaching to us today? Like, really? Like, he didn't want to pray. Like, okay, well, I'm sorry. Maybe you can preach next week. Talk to pastor about it. Maybe your life is better than mine, okay? Get over it. I got the microphone. So what I'm saying is I noticed the carnality in myself. I was like, ugh. I mean, I still made myself pray, but I was like, and that's what Paul's talking about. There's a flesh in us, and we want to build the Spirit. We want to listen to the Spirit. We want to engage in the Spirit. What you feed on is what you're going to get. And if we're living our life according to the flesh, the Bible promises us that we will die. And that's a spiritual death, maybe, but either which way, I don't think dying is good. Keep going. Let's jump down to verse 9. It says, but you are not, and I love this kind of turnaround. Sometimes we can get like, oh no, I'm controlled by the flesh. No, this is us. But you are not controlled by your sinful nature. You are controlled by the Spirit if you have the Spirit of God living on the inside of you. And remember that those who do not have the Spirit of Christ living in them do not belong to him at all. I just want to take a moment. Don't hold your coworkers to the standards of Christianity when they're not having the Spirit of God on the inside of them. Don't cover your mouth in the sense of like, oh, I can't believe they did that. Oh, they're so dirty. Because the flesh on the inside of them is not controlled by the Spirit of God. And they're like, why are we surprised when sinners act like sinners? And why do we act as if we're so clean, like we made ourselves that way? We didn't. Jesus did. So stop being a jerk and judgmental, and let's help some people get right with God rather than be like, oh, I can't believe they did that. That's just a free one. Tweet that. We need to help people. There's an old adage, you can win more people with, it's more with honey rather than vinegar or something like that. Be sweet, be kind. Okay, let's get off that. We haven't even prayed yet, y'all. You were controlled by the Spirit if you have the Spirit of God living in the inside. Verse 10, and Christ lives within you. So even though your body will die because of sin, the Spirit gives life because you have been made right with God. The Spirit of God who raised Jesus from the dead, he lives in you. And just as God raised Christ Jesus from the dead, he will give you life in your mortal bodies by his same Spirit living within you. Therefore, dear brothers and sisters, he was from the south. You have no obligation to do what your sinful nature urges you to do. I'm not under no obligation to obey my flesh when it wants to rule and reign. I'm a no obligation. Sometimes people give me that. I couldn't help it. Yes, you can, according to the word. No, you don't understand. I couldn't help it. Well, if you're setting your mind on the things of the flesh, you bet you're being controlled by the flesh. But you are under no obligation to listen to what the flesh dictates you to do. That should be good news for some of us who are battling stuff. But this is the way out. Verse 13. For if you live by its dictates, you will die. But if through the power of the Spirit you put to death the deeds of your sinful nature, you will live. Well, how do we do it? Where's the power? Where's the power source? It's through the Spirit. We put to death those things on the inside of us. Gives us a renewal, if you may. Verse 14, for all who are led by the Spirit of God, these are the children of God. I like to say it another way. As you be a child of God, you get to be led by the Spirit of God. Sometimes we almost use that as a cop-out or like a cutting-off point. Like, if you're not led, you're not a child of God. No, that's not what it says. It says, those who are children of God, they're led by the Spirit of God. That should be good news to us. That means we can hear God's voice. That means we can listen to Him and we can get dictated. And Lord, He can correct us and move us and change us, and we can kind of work in sync with Him. That's good news. You can hear. Say that. Say, I can hear God's voice. I can hear God's voice. Amen. We're going to pray today. The title of tonight's topic, talk, preach, whatever you want to call it, is From Here to There, okay? From Here to There. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the word. Help me preach. Help them listen. I pray that our hearts are open and receptive. Just like I know heaven is open and that you are willing to talk and share. And Father, I pray that not one in here would be holding on tight to our thinking and not willing to change. I pray for correction in love, and I pray that correction is received, and I pray that we are all moving toward you, going exactly where we're supposed to be at exactly the right time. Thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, I believe in the exact will of God for your life. I don't know how to explain it because there's so many different, I mean, you can almost have like this, like, okay, was I supposed to step on that stair right there? No, I don't know if that's it, but I believe in being in the right place at the right time. I believe in divine appointments. I believe that you coincidentally chose the right store that crosses paths with the right person that can literally affect them for eternity. I believe in that, and because it's happened in the Bible, it's happened in my own life, it's happened in your life, I'm suspecting. God puts you sometimes with your help, sometimes without your help, and He gets you to the right place. And I don't know about you, I want to be in the right place at the right time. I don't believe in just kind of flippantly going through life. John Maxwell said it this way: life is in session, are you present? Sometimes we're asking for like, can I get a dress rehearsal real quick? Can I just run my first 20 years with a dress rehearsal and maybe I'll get it right after that? No, I want to be present right now doing what I'm supposed to be doing right now. How many of you guys have ever been on a road trip? Now, I'm not talking like seaside road trip. You know, I stopped off at the water area because it got tired in the car. I'm talking like multi-state, multi-restrooms. I'm talking about the restrooms where you have to ask Barbara behind the counter if you can have the key to the bathroom. And it comes usually in a big, long wooden spoon that's kind of cracked and yellowy. And you're like, why is that wood yellow? It's like, and you just don't even want to touch the spoon. But as you take the spoon past it, everybody knows you're going to the bathroom. You're like, I'm looking for the bathroom. And you go in there and you open up the bathroom and you're like, oh man, I should have just stopped on the side of the road. This is not good. I'm going to catch something. No, I'm talking that kind of road trip. I'm talking fast food road trip. I'm talking you need a GPS road trip. My wife and I, crazily, but it was really fun. She's not here to kind of egg me on, but we had a really good time. We went from Oregon to Virginia Beach this time last year. We went through 11 states. We did it over the course of 4 days, and it was a blast. I actually highly recommend it. There was a lot of parts that are unnecessary. It usually starts in like end of Wyoming, actually the beginning of Wyoming. I thought Wyoming, I heard Wyoming was like Teton Mountains. I never saw any of that. I saw sagebrush and this place where you get ice cream for a dollar. What's it called? It's two for a dollar. It was in the middle of nowhere and there was a bunch of trucks. You could buy like a magnet and stuff. Anyway, this road trip was crazy. One thing I learned about this journey, and I'm relating this to your life, and so I'll get there. It's not the bathroom part, but this thing was a long journey. I realized a couple of things in this truck. As we went, every little bit you stopped, you wasted a lot of time quickly. like, I was like, because I was like, I don't know if guys or any guys can relate. I'm always just trying to get there. I don't know why, but I'm trying to get there. There's something in me like, we need to go and we need to go now. I'm trying to get there. Once you get there, you can waste all the time you want, but somehow in my brain, I'm trying to get there. And so I'm like, gotta move. Come on, gotta move. And one time we stopped off, it was somewhere in Missouri. We got a flat tire and my dad didn't, I was taking his truck and he didn't have a wrench that takes off one of the top flat tires. So you could, Walmart guys couldn't even change my tire. And I was like, oh my goodness. So we ended up just kind of at Walmart, between Walmart food and trying to find a tire. It was 6 hours. And how many know when you're on a road trip, 6 hours kills the day. Now all of a sudden we're not making this city, we're making another city. And I was amazed by the just the little distraction of the journey that it cut our time to our destination greatly. And it was one of those things that I was thinking about this, and I was thinking about your life, and I was thinking about my life, and we are on a journey. Your life is a journey. And the destination is really heaven, and God saying, well done, good and faithful servant. I don't want to just begin well, I want to finish well. And I believe that there will be stop-off points along the way that will be indicators of how I'm really doing, right? And the success levels. And really what's so cool is God never stops in your success. I believe that he's really trying to take us further, take us. But if you're not careful, you can throw the GPS of the Holy Spirit out the window and begin to drive and think that you're still on the track that you're supposed to be on. And just because we're driving, we think that we're driving to Virginia Beach, and you might not be driving that way at all. Just because we're driving, you think that, yeah, I'm driving, I'm doing what God's called me to do, but you might have not checked in. And it's so easy to miss just one exit. It's so easy just to take a little bit too long, and you can be hanging out in the Walmart parking lot for too long, and you think that you're still on your way, but you're not. And today, I want to bring just a little bit of correction, I believe. I believe God wants to get some of us right back on track. You're frustrated in life. You're sitting there in that Walmart parking lot spiritually, and you're like, man, life sucks. And that's not the journey. That's not the destination. That's not where you're supposed to be at. And you're frustrated, and you're angry, and listen, you're like me. You're like, I thought we were going to be further along by now. But you're not. It's because you haven't checked in with the Lord. You are not able, I'm going to say something, and some of you are like, yes, I can. You cannot plan your own way. You cannot plan your own way. You're not smart enough. I don't care about your five-year plan. And I love five-year plans. Mind you, I'm a planner. But you need to bathe that five-year plan in prayer. You need to realize that you are not smart enough. And so sometimes that plan needs to change. And you might, here's something that people do. They get zealous. Maybe they hear like a facet of their call. I'm just going to be honest with sometimes ministers do this. They're in a position just like I am right now. I sense God's calling on my life and I'm feeling good. And they're like, all right. And then they go start their own church. They're like, oh, I'm going to see you later. God's calling me, and they're toiling, and life sucks. But because they said that, oh, God told me to do this, now we got to keep going through it. And they can't have enough honesty with people around them and themselves to say, man, I missed God. I shouldn't have ran out and done this. And because they went and blabbed to everybody, said, God told me to do this, they're too afraid, and they got too much pride to turn around and stop. That's a real deal. I see it all the time. And we have to have enough kind of like day in, daily manna from the Lord, and where he talks and we listen, he talks and we listen, he talks and we listen. And just like James says, it says, we don't know what we're going to do. If the Lord wills and everything works out, this is what we're going to do, because I am waiting on the Lord and the leading of the Lord. And if you talk that way, sometimes even your Christian friends will look at you weird. They're like, oh, if the Lord decides, huh? Yeah. If the Lord decides, if the Lord makes that way and we get to go there, I'm dependent on his voice. Are you? And it's only our spiritual friends who would do that. And the rest of us, we're just going to make do. No. I hope our life is not just making do. I hope that we don't take that GPS like, oh, I'm going to turn it off for a little bit. I got this. I know where I'm going. What is it with guys and knowing where they're going? No, you don't. You have no clue. And listen to me very closely. If you do know where you're going, that's because you've already been there, and that's probably not where God's trying to take you. He brings you out of a place where you don't know where you're going. He brings you to places and spaces where you're not comfortable any longer. And if you got this all figured out, you are not yet dependent on him. He wants you at this place like, oh, all right, what next? It's humility. I want you to think about Moses taking people through the desert. I mean, you got millions of people dependent on you. You think your payroll's tough. Imagine Moses. He's got all of Israel dependent on him. And this is what he says. Look at this. Exodus chapter 33. He was smart enough to realize he needed the Lord's help. Guys, it's humility. I really feel like what we're addressing today is the pride and the arrogancy of us that we think that we can actually manage our own life. And I know that that sounds, like I said, I feel like as even as I say that, some of you are like, I can manage my own life. No, you can't. I'm talking to you right now. That's not wrong to say, why would the clay say that it's better than the potter? Like, that's not weakness for us to be like, no, I like need God. And what's bad is sometimes we've had a level of success and God really brought you that success and you've done really well for yourself and you start like, I'm pretty good. I can do this thing. I'm winning. Like, maybe you have a mortgage now and you're able to pay it. You got a job that maybe, and you got that life insurance and you got your 401k set and you're like, I am the man. I'm winning. I'm adulting. Hashtag adulting. And we start saying, like, I got this figured out. I know where I'm going. Grab that GPS. Throw that out the window. I brought me here. I brought me this far along. And all the while, you need to say, where's that GPS? Where's that GPS? Put it back in. God, your life is, my life is your life. My plans are your plans. My thoughts are your thoughts. Lord, where are we leading me? Where are we going to next? And listen, no one in this place is exempt from this conversation with the Lord. No one in this place, you have gone too far where God doesn't need to dictate your life any longer. No one in this place is free from interruption, I hope, from the Holy Spirit, where you thought you were going one place and he stops you and say, no, we're going to another. Are you paying attention, church? Because there are souls and people at stake. And the second you start running your own life, you will chase things like money and accolades from men, and you will do things that for other benefits, your own social benefits, not the benefits of the kingdom of heaven. Why? Because sometimes our flesh thinks, and listen to me very closely, sometimes you can be even doing God things that are wrong. Wrong time. Wrong place. Wrong use of your time. Holy Spirit is speaking tonight. Today. What day is it? Where are we? Keep going. It's almost night. Exodus 33. Moses was smart enough to say this, and I love it. Moses 33:15. It says, Moses says, if you, I'm going to back up to 12. It says, one day Moses said to the Lord, you've been telling me, take these people to the promised land. Like, look, we're going on a journey, but you haven't told me whom you will send with me. I need help. I need some help. You have told me, I know you by name, and I look favorably on you. But if this is true, then look favorably on me and let me know your ways so I may understand you more fully and continue to enjoy your favor. You know what they say? Moses was one of the most humble men of his day. There was a humility about him saying, man, I don't got this. I don't got this right. I don't got this yet. And we start thinking that we got it. And we've been saved for 3 years, 2 years, 5 years. We're like, yeah, I got this down. I know how to hear God's voice. Well, do you? Are you in really a position to hear? Or are you telling God what's up? Verse 14 says, the Lord replies, says, I will personally go with you, Moses. I will give you rest and everything will be fine for you. I love that. That's our God. Like, I'm good. I just take the steering wheel. This thing tells me where to go. I go. Ain't no big deal. I will have rest. It'll be easy. And I'm not saying life will be easy. I'm saying God's leading will be easy. There'll be joy. 15, Moses says, if you do not personally go with me, don't make us leave this place. How will anybody know that you look favorably on me and on your people if you don't go with us? For your presence sets your people and me apart from all the other people of the earth. What separates us from everybody else? The presence of God. We dictating our own way? Nope. We doing our own thing? Uh-uh. You go to the gym and you lift weights with the help of the Holy Spirit. You know what I'm saying? We, everything we do, God, you're with me. You're helping me. You're showing me things. People, you get a revelation from the Lord. Somebody asks you, where did you get that? Say, God gave that to me. God showed me that. I couldn't have saw that by myself. I need his help. I need his guidance. You get a witty idea about your job. You do something that helps your company. People, where did you get to come up with that information? Oh, the Lord helped me on that one. I got him. Man, he's good. He's faithful. He helps me. Has he been helping you? Look at one scripture in Nehemiah 9. This is the prophet. He said, verse 19, he says, but in your great mercy, you did not abandon them to die in the wilderness. This is talking about Israel. It says, the pillar of cloud still led them forward by day, and the pillar of fire showed them the way through the night. Back in the Old Testament, even then, the children of Israel, led by a cloud, led by fire. The Lord was with them. You sent your good spirit to instruct them, and you did not stop giving them manna from heaven and water for their thirst. For 40 years, you sustained them in the wilderness. They lacked nothing. Their clothes did not wear out. Their feet did not swell. You know, this story of like, I always like, I'm a destination person, right? And if we think, hey, yeah, I got to get there. Could you imagine being the 18-year-old, 16-year-old man? It says that everybody below 20, you had to die. And then what if you just like barely made that cut off? And you're like, wait a second, we're not getting there until I'm 60 now? Like for 40 years now, you're going to be wandering in the desert. Like, thanks, guys. Appreciate that. Like that was awesome. I was going to be young in the manna, in the land of milk and honey. This is a two-week journey, but now we're taking 40 years. Now listen to me closely. Brother Hagin said it this way. God told him, it says, most people live and die in the first phase of their ministry. They never enter into the second phase. Well, what's the second phase? That means they never make progress to where they're really supposed to be at. There's that bumper sticker, not whole, who wander are lost. I disagree with that. There was sometimes in Christianity, in our journeying, we're just wandering. We're just wondering. We make decisions and business decisions. Like, yeah, sure, I'll give this a try. Guys, that's not the way we're supposed to do things. The Spirit of God should be wooing us and drawing us and showing us the things. And we should know where we go with prayerful thought. Lord, this is what you're telling me to do right now. I know it. I hear your voice. This is where I'm going. And the world does not have this hope. And this separates us from the world. Moses says, if you're not going with me, I'm not going. And he says that God went with him. Everywhere they for 40 years. Listen to me. What I love about that 40 years is that even in your stupidity, God's there. Even in your ignorance, God's there leading you, wooing you. So listen to me. The good news is that if you're in a hole right now, if you feel like you're wandering in the desert, God is there. The Spirit of God is there to help you out. The Spirit of God is show you what you did wrong and help you get out of it. Aren't you grateful? So it doesn't matter where you're at. We can start listening. Doesn't matter what you've done, you can start listening. If you're his sheep, you hear his voice. And we can begin to say, God, what's the next step for me? And listen to why. There are places for you to go, people for you to reach. It's not in your own vocabulary up in your brain. You can't just navigate this on your own. Look at this, Proverbs. Our life now is built on better promises. Children of Israel, they got the pillar of fire and the cloud. We now have the person of the Holy Spirit to lead us and who lives in us and can dictate to us what we need to do and where we need to go and how we need to do it. A lot of times we are simply ignoring the leading of the Holy Spirit. And what I mean by that is then God, has anybody ever got corrected by the Lord? Let me put it this way. Has anybody, God ever told you to do something and your heart sinks? Usually for me, it involves an amount of money. It involves maybe an item that I purchased that I particularly like. I even make the joke, sometimes I don't like to like any of the things I have. I'm like, if I like it too much, the Lord will tell me to give it away. So I just, yeah, it's all right. I don't even care about that. Maybe I'm the only one. I don't like it, Lord. I don't like that at all. You know. But anyways, if he's ever told you to do something, you're just like, oh no. And listen to me, you could sit in a service like that and you could be like, oh, that sucks. That burns a little bit. I don't want to do that. And you're like, and you kind of sit on it for a while and then you're like, okay, service is ended. And then you're like, all right, let's go get some teriyaki, kids. You eat some food. And you try to like just live life over the voice. Does that make sense? And you can hear that and you're like, what voice? I don't hear anything. Give the truck away. Like, get behind me, Satan. And you're just trying to like push it down. Listen to me. You can push it down so much that God stops talking. I believe some of us have done that. He told you to do something and it didn't make sense. He told you to do something and it didn't make financial sense. It didn't fit your budget. Dave Ramsey wouldn't have done it. But God messes with our stuff to check our obedience. And if that sinking feeling's there, and I want you to listen to today, I hope that God brings that to your remembrance. Because your growth, your influence on other people, it starts and stops at your obedience. Tweet that again. Do that. I'm gonna pay attention very closely. Your growth, your point from here to there, that progress that you're hoping for, that you're wanting, that one day when we get to heaven, you're going to hear, well done, good and faithful servant, that depends on your obedience. Whether you obey when he tells you to do those little things. Give that jacket away. Give the car away. Just quit this job. Go to this job. Do this, do that. Man, dude, when I was 15, I was trying to get jobs at places, and God would bother me and not let me work at places. I almost got to the point where I was like, dude, do you hate me? Do you not want me employed? Like I went to Subway and in my spirit, I just knew that it was wrong. I was like, God, I can make a sandwich. I am qualified. But I was being led. I ended up at Red Robin. And I remember even as I like turned in the application, I was like, I'm not hearing anything. It's just good. I can go here. And guys, I mean, maybe I was overzealous, but how many of us have gotten so over the other route where we don't even include God on anything? I just do my own thing. I cash this at 401k. Yeah, I'll cash it in. I'll do, buying houses and buying cars and we do just because we want them. And just, we don't even ask God whether it's good money or whether we don't ask whether he's got a better deal. Keith Moore, one of our guys that talks a lot about being led by the Holy Ghost. He's a pastor in Missouri or Atlanta, somewhere over there. Some of those states that I didn't drive through. He says he was sitting in front of a building. It was a good deal. It ended up it was everything that he wanted. It was a good price. He had the money for it. And he was sitting in front of the building. And he says the Holy Ghost wouldn't let him buy and purchase this building for their second campus. And he's like, God. And he was almost getting mad at him. Like, God, like this is the deal. This is a good deal. What do you, and he was, got upset. It was just, it didn't feel right. He says he couldn't do it. And God wasn't really telling him why. And so he waited on it just a couple of weeks. And thankfully, another building came up, a building that didn't look like it. I think it was even before it was even put on for sale. He ended up with somebody just barely meeting them. And it was a better building at a better price, at a better location, something above that he could even have thought on his own. Well, that's how God leads you. Sometimes we look at a car and we're like, that's the car. I want this, especially don't go test drive the thing. But we start test driving it. And listen, if you're smart enough, you'll even look at a car and God will be like, nope. And you're like, I've done it at least. And God's like, I'm like, God, are you serious? This is it, but it's a red one. Lord, I want the red one. And God knows what you want. He's got something better for you, but it takes patience. It takes waiting on the Lord. And guys, this is for everybody in this building. Waiting on the Lord. Learning to hear his voice. Learning to be directed. Learning to be instructed. It's a humility, this moment of God, I'm listening. And so Paul, actually, I'm going to read some scriptures in Proverbs real quick. So Proverbs, it says, 16, it says, we can make our plans, but the Lord determines our steps. Proverbs 20, verse 24, it says, the Lord directs our steps. So why do try to understand everything along the way? Like, just pay attention to God. God's got you. He knows what he's doing with your life. And I love this. This is Jeremiah, the prophet, verse 10:23 says, I know, Lord, that our lives are not our own. Isn't that a good thought? So now I'm in charge of my life. Are you really? Like, should you be, though? That's like leaving an 8-year-old in charge of a house. Like, is that a good plan? I don't know. I mean, it might be a responsible 8-year-old, but no. You're not qualified. And if that bothers you, it shows your pride level. If you're sitting here saying, no, I can run my life, I'm talking to you. I need God. You need God. I need his instruction. I need his guidance. And I love this. It says that our lives are on our own. We are not able to plan our own course. That's Jeremiah. He was pretty smart. Not able to plan our own course. Go to Acts chapter 16. And this was Paul and Silas. And sometimes when we were talking about being led by the God, we think that at every given second, God's going to have to direct us. You know, Cheerios or Lucky Charms this morning. And God's like, neither. Both are carbs. You need protein. No. You know, sometimes we start thinking like, Lord, should I wear this shirt or that shirt? Like, we don't need to get weird. The Bible, my favorite part is one of the things I was thinking about says that God came and talked to Adam in the cool of the day. That means it was a daily thing, and that also means that the day had already gone by. What did God want Adam to do? Sit around, just sit in the garden, wait for his instruction? No, live your life. You know, get a job, go do things, work on stuff, but don't ever be so busy that you don't have time to talk to God in the cool of the day, that you haven't checked in with your Father. That's how we live this thing. It's go and live your life. Go thrive. Go get jobs. Go do your, but never be so busy that God can't interrupt, change, move. And listen, when you hear that leading, you stop and obey. Don't lie to yourself and be like, oh yeah, well, I'm hearing a left, but I'm just going to keep going straight. I know where I'm going. I feel like this is the way. And sometimes, listen, some of y'all are happy about going the wrong way. And you're defiantly just, no, this is what I'm doing with my life. And you're going the wrong way. Your friends can see it. Your pastors can see it. And they try to talk to you about it. You're like, no, I'm going the right way. Like, it's the other way. It's the other way. You've turned the GPS off, and you're trying to run your own life. Paul, Silas, these dudes knew God. They walked with God. They talked with God. They were preaching God. They were literally going to die for the gospel, okay? These guys had a pretty good spiritual life, and it says they wanted to go somewhere, and the Holy Spirit prevented them. Don't you like that? Look at this. This is Acts 16. Where are we at? Let me jump over there myself. Acts 16, verse 6, it says, next, Paul and Silas traveled through the area of Phrygia and Galatia because the Holy Spirit had prevented them from preaching the word in the province of Asia at that time. It says the Holy Spirit prevented them from preaching. What? That means I could be doing the right thing at the wrong time, in the wrong place? You betcha. Some of y'all are preaching at your family and they ain't ready. And the Holy Spirit's been telling you to shut up. And you're like, nope, they need to hear this. I'm going to tell them in love. No, it's not that much love. You need to shut up. You can preach the gospel at the wrong time. That's what it said. That's what they did. And they were smart enough to not keep going. So they're like, oh, yeah, we're prevented. Verse 7, and then they came into the borders of Mysia, and they headed north to the province of Bithynia. But again, the Spirit of Jesus did not allow them to go there. And I love that he purposely wrote the Spirit of Jesus. Because sometimes there's another hindering spirit that hinders us from preaching the gospel. And he wanted them to know that it was the Holy Spirit that stopped them from going up there. The Holy Spirit. And now listen to me. Paul's like, I'm going to go here. I'm going to go do this. And the Holy Spirit's like, no, don't do that. Paul. Why didn't Paul just wake up in the morning and get an instruction and go? Why didn't he didn't have to get interrupted? Why did he even think about going up there if the Holy? Because we are led daily. We're dependent on God's voice, even Paul. God doesn't just set the whole plan for you all at once. He doesn't. He doesn't do that. I don't know. I wish he did. We could write it down. We'd probably mess it up somehow. So he's headed that way, and God stopped him and turned him. Look at this, and then verse 9, Paul had a vision that night. A man in Macedonia in northern Greece was standing and pleading them, come over to Macedonia and help us. So we decided to leave Macedonia at once, having concluded that God was calling us to preach the good news there. And I left this part out, but where they wanted to go, there was more Jews in that area, meaning that it would have been easier for them to preach the gospel. There would have been more places for them to get, you know, get housing and get support. It would have been basically the difference of a, let's go up to Oregon where maybe it's very liberal for the gospel versus let's go to Oklahoma. It was a place basically they were going to be more accepted. You know, God calls you out of your comfort zone. God takes you places where it's like, dude, God, really? There? That's where you want me to go? What? That's what he did. He's going to call him there. But this is the why. 10 or 11. He says they boarded the boat and they sailed across the island of Cyprus. And the next day they landed in Neapolis. And from there they reached Philippi, a major city in the district of Macedonia, a Roman colony. And they stayed there several days. On the Sabbath, they went a little way out into the city, outside the city, to a riverbank where they thought people would be meeting for prayer. So they were trying to find some Christians because it was a Roman city, most likely not a God-fearing place. They're trying to go on the outskirts of town and look what they find. And they stayed there several days. And on the Sabbath, they went a little far. Verse 14, one of them, there was a person, there was women that had gathered there. Verse 14, one of them was Lydia of Thyatira, a merchant of expensive purple cloth who worshiped God. And as she listened to us, the Lord opened her heart and she accepted what Paul was saying. She was baptized along with other members of her household and she asked us to be her guests. And basically she compelled them to come into her house. So this woman of influence gets saved. I love this story because it just goes to show that God would change a prophet's plans or an apostle's plans to get one person saved. What plans are you allowing him to change in your life so somebody could get saved? I'm going to have the band come up right now, and we're going to sing a song, and we're going to take a moment. I mean, what can we do? Can we come up and bring you all up here, make you pray? Like, listen to God in Jesus' name. Listen to God in Jesus' name. I don't think we can do that. But you know what's really beautiful? This affects every person in here. Nobody is exempt from this. And I think the worst thing to do is to be sitting there driving in the journey of your life and to say, oh, yeah, I'm listening to God. Yeah, I'm good. Why do you even preach this message, Pastor Nate? Like, I mean, I'm good. Or we bring our shovel to church with us. We take it. We like, man, I wish my friend Sally was here. She needed this. I mean, I'm listening to the Lord, but Sally needed it. No. We're talking to you. No one's exempt from this. You cannot plan your own way. You got kingdom business to do, God business to do. And so as we sing this song, I want us to reflect, everyone in here. God, am I listening? Did I get off on an exit at all? Did I change my own plan? And did I do my own thing? Did I miss something? Did I throw the GPS at any point? Listen to me, sometimes you can want your own plan more than God's plan, and you think that it's God's plan because you wanted your own. And that's when we get to the place of happily doing our own thing. I'm not saying that God's plan makes you angry or you don't want to do it, but there definitely has to be a dying to yourself and a dying to your own plan. And guys, we don't need to overanalyze this. You either hear God's voice or you don't. And I know you do. When he corrects you, you know it. That's the same voice. Same voice that's directing you. Sometimes we overanalyze. What do you want me to do? Just listen. Position yourself for obedience. Position yourself to listen. Position yourself to obey. And then just go ahead and settle it. God, I'm going to do anything you tell me to do. My money's yours. My time's yours. My influence is yours. My job's yours. My kids are yours. Everything. You got my life. There's a commentary by Matthew Henry. This is for the Bible scholars in this place. But I love this because it shows how God interrupted a normal day. It says, among the hearers of Paul was a woman. Her name was Lydia. She had an honest calling. Well, what was an honest calling? She was a seller of fine linen. She was well off. She did well for herself. She's killing it. All of her neighbors thought she was successful. I was like, man, she's the man. That was weird. Okay. Hashtag killing it. She had an honest calling, which the historian notices to her praise. Yet though she had a calling in mind, she found time to improve advantages for her soul. She found time to improve advantages for her soul. It will not excuse us from our religious duties to say we have a trade to mind. For have not we also a God to serve and souls to look after? Religion does not call us from our business in the world, but it directs us in it.
That's good.
I'm going to say that again. Religion does not call us from our business in the world, but directs us in it. Religion does not call us from our business in the world, but directs us in it. Guys, we need to include God in our businesses. We need to include God in our plans. This is what it means to be led by the Spirit of God. This is what it means to be a Christian. This is what separates us from the world, that His presence is among us.
Yeah.
You look different, talk different, walk different, are different.
Yeah.
And all the praise to be to the glory of God. God is trying to move you from here to there. From here to there. But you got to listen. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Real quick, before we do this, I don't know everybody in here. And really, the first step to hearing God's voice and to being led by the Spirit of God is to know God and to surrender your life to Him. That means to be born again, to be saved. The Bible calls it is literally dying to yourself and giving your life to Jesus. If you're in this place and you've never received Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you never said, Jesus, take the wheel, you have my life, it's yours. That's the first step. And I want to give you that opportunity right now. No one messing around, no one looking around, no one's judging anybody. We're all rooting for you. And if you've never done that, I want to give you that moment right now. And on the count of three, I want you to raise your hand high and bold. We're going to pray a simple prayer. And it's just a prayer of offering up our life to God. It's a prayer of salvation. It's saying, God, I need you. I don't have my life figured out. I'm a sinner. I'm no good without you, but with you, I'm good. On the count of three, one. Come on. This is the most important decision. This is a moment of salvation. A moment of decision of you saying, God, I can't rule my own life. Two, I want to be born again for the very first time. Or you want to rededicate your life even. Three, right now, raise your hand if that's you. Say, man, I want to give my life to Jesus. All right, I see that hand. I see that hand. Come on, come on. I want to give my life to Jesus. I'm not dictating my own life any longer. Come on, come on, come on. There's one more in this place. If that's you, God's pounding. Maybe your heart's pounding. You can put your hand up, put it right back down. I'm not trying to embarrass you. God loves you. He has a plan for your life. You're here for a purpose, and you're here just like Lydia was. Come on, I'll wait just one more second. I believe there's God's drawing you right now. God's drawing you. Come on, come on, come on. Shoot your hand up high and bold and put it right back down. Saints are praying. Father, we thank you. I want everybody to stand up with me, say this prayer. For those who raised their hand, I want you to, I'm not even going to embarrass you and bring you up just because we're gonna sing this song, but I want you to, God knows exactly where you're at. I want you to say this, say, Father God, I believe in my heart. I confess with my mouth that Jesus is Lord. I believe it. I'm a sinner, but I call on Jesus right now. I give you my life. I give you my everything. Have your way. Not my plans, your plans. Not my will, your will. Direct me from here on out. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. Come on, can we give those people a hand who, give them a hand, come on. That's salvation. And listen, I want you to approach Pastor Brian is right here. I want you to come and talk to him at the end of service, those who raise their hands, because he's got a book for you. He wants to encourage you and just kind of help you along the way. As the rest of us, we're going to sing this song, and then the band's going to dismiss us. But as we sing this song, I want you to tune your heart towards heaven. Don't leave this place like God maybe dropped something on your heart and you go eat teriyaki and forget all about it. I want you to take this moment and kind of seal the deal that, man, I'm gonna obey. I'm gonna obey. Whatever God's telling me to do, I'm gonna obey. I'm gonna go back to the thing, that exit that I took off, and I should have gone and I didn't. I'm gonna turn around, I'm gonna do a U-turn if I need to, and I'm gonna do what God's called me to do. Amen. Amen. Come on, let's sing this song.